So how do you manage anemia in cases of radiation when somebody's maybe taking Zoladex or on some form of androgen deprivation therapy?
Mostly, unless it's really extreme, I ignore it, because we know that men who have their testosterone blocked will develop relative anemia. Let's define a few terms. What is anemia? Anemia is a lower than expected number of red cells in the bloodstream. And this is measured as a percentage. So you have serum, which is just the clear fluid, then you have the red cells, which is like a slurry of cells that are suspended in the serum. So normally the red cells in men represents about 45% of the total blood. And when you block testosterone, the percentage drops down to around 35%. And for women who don't have testosterone, 35% is normal. For men who do have testosterone, 35% is abnormal, and it's called anemia. So I've seen a lot of wasted time and energy for people who are on Lupron or Zoladex or Firmagon, doctors pursuing, you know, iron deficiency and other causes of anemia, when really it should be obvious that when testosterone is low, men become anemic. It is possible for people to become even more anemic, and the hematocrit could drop down to, say, below 30%. And I think you need to go looking for other reasons. That's extreme, just simply because someone doesn't have testosterone in their bloodstream. So the anemia of androgen deprivation, anemia of testosterone deprivation, or of hormone blockade is commonplace. It's expected. It doesn't usually have much in the way of any specific ramifications. People aren't out of breath as a result. When anemia becomes very severe, it's the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood that allows you to breathe normally. So if someone's hematocrit drops down to, say, 25%, they could be out of breath with minimal exercise. But it's mostly just a number that people notice is out of range and gets people concerned, but it's to be expected in people that are taking testosterone blockade.
So we have a patient who's on radiation. They've had 9 weeks of radiation, and they're wondering, should they go get a CT scan to see if the size of the prostate has shrunk after this radiation treatment?
I get this question quite a bit. After all the decision-making and the study and what do we do and how do we do it, and finally the program is set up, and things go smoothly now in this modern era when people are being treated by top-level experts. And it almost seems simple after it's all said and done. What further things do I need to do to make sure that the cancer doesn't come back? And it's surprisingly simple, because while PSA for screening purposes to find out if there's any cancer there in the normal population is not a great test, it's a useful test, but there's a lot of imperfections, and people know that you can't just trust the PSA 100% to find cancer in the normal population. Whereas after treatment, if the whole prostate was treated, the PSA should decline over a period of 6, 12 to 18 months to less than 0.5 and stay there indefinitely. And if it does, that's something you can take to the bank. The possibility of a clinically significant cancer that's misbehaving in someone after radiation treatment with a PSA less than 0.5 is less than 1%. So there's no need to be doing additional scans or checkups as long as the PSA is under 0.5 after radiation, and assuming that the testosterone is in the normal range. There are reasons that PSAs can go above 0.5 that are not cancerous, and those things have been discussed in other videos about the PSA bump and whatnot. But when the PSA is low, there isn't any need to be going and doing additional scanning if there aren't any other extenuating circumstances.
We did a video on robotic surgery versus a standard non-robotic, and we were kind of going over the incision size. What is the incision size from a robotic surgery to a non-robotic surgery? Because I know people who are looking at this are kind of wondering what, you know, the aftermath of this may be.
Well, robotic surgery has become so common. When people talk about prostate surgery, they're almost always talking about robotic surgery, where if you go back 10 years, in the old days, they used to put a big incision that went from just above your pubic bone all the way up to your breastbone, and that was how they were able to access the prostate area and remove the prostate surgically. So these days, with robotic surgery, they go through little tiny ports, little tiny scars on this, where they insert their these devices that operate inside. And so the difference in the scarring after the treatment, or the scar that you deal with cosmetically, is huge. And I think that's one of the big advantages. I wish there were other big advantages of robotic surgery. I wish the robotic surgeons had been able to reduce the incidence of erectile dysfunction or the incidence of urinary incontinence. Unfortunately, neither of those have been improved with robotic surgery. But the reduction in the size of the scars, absolutely, big advantage for robotic surgery. And because the scars are smaller, people recover more quickly. They go home from the hospital sooner. So that's a nice and certainly a good thing about robotic surgery. But the things that matter, the long-term issues, will you be more likely to have good urinary control? Will you be more likely to maintain normal erections? Unfortunately, was not altered by the advent of robotic surgery.
So TULSA-PRO has come up as a big conversation piece due to marketing and the fact that it came out here in the U.S. And so people are kind of wondering, what are the pros and cons? And then one of the patients wrote in and said that they heard that focal laser ablation from their doctor, they heard that their focal laser ablation is much better than TULSA-PRO. So they're wondering what your truth is, Dr. Scholz, is based off of these two treatments.
Well, both these treatments are being utilized in a custom fashion. So when men are diagnosed with prostate cancer, they may have small tumors, they may have big tumors, they may have high-grade tumors, they may have low-grade tumors. They may have big prostates, they may have small prostates. They may have different goals in terms of how urgently they want to sustain the normal ability to get erections. All these variables have a lot more to do with the skill of the physician in identifying exactly where the cancer is and what the appropriate margin is around the area that they're proposing to treat will be. All those skills are so much more important than whether you're trying to destroy the tissue with a laser or with high-intensity focused ultrasound. Both methodologies are quite capable of destroying tissue and killing cancer. So it's the skill level of the doctor administering the treatment. Now, some people are arguing that because the TULSA-PRO is done inside an MRI, that it's going to be easier to deliver the targeting that you desire compared to other various methods of cryosurgery, laser therapy, all these other methodologies. There's a component of taking a picture and then figuring out where to go, whereas with the TULSA-PRO, you're under direct visualization when they're treating the spot. Seems like it should offer advantages. The reality of that, I think, is too early to say. I would certainly be much more comfortable with a doctor who's got a proven track record of delivering the goods, eliminating the cancer, and not causing collateral damage than thinking that, boy, if I just go to a doctor who has the right piece of equipment, everything will be fine. It's not going to be that easy, unfortunately.
Well, I think if patients are interested in TULSA-PRO, it sounds like a good idea. What you've mentioned in the past is that they can contact the company and find out who's a known practitioner, somebody the company's worked with who's an expert in this field, and go ahead and take a look at their experience and interview them as a doctor for the treatment. I think that sounds like the good end result. Hey everybody, it's me, Alex, and our mascot here, Hunter. He's obviously licking my hands because we have lots of treats for him today. But yeah, we just wanted to let you know to go ahead and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We come out with new prostate cancer videos every week. And go ahead and check him out on Instagram at Sir Hunter the Dow. Also, check out our website, PCRI.org, for more information about prostate cancer. We hope it helps.